There's actually a few different complications in terms of how diabetes can affect your eye. One of which is you can have changes in your glasses prescription. If your blood sugar is poorly controlled, the prescription can either go up or down, and usually that's an intermittent thing until control is well established again. You can also have higher risk of corneal ulcers with contact lens wear, so it becomes more important to follow a contact lens patient more regularly if they have diabetes. Glaucoma is a possible side effect to diabetes. You can also have cataracts earlier in life with diabetes. And of course, the most common complication of diabetes is diabetic retinopathy. Diabetic retinopathy is the disease process by which diabetes affects the retina. So let me tell you what the retina is first. The retina is the tissue of the inside of the eye. It's essentially a lining of the inside back half of the eye that acts as the movie screen of the eye. When light shines through your pupil and through your lens, it focuses on the retina. And the retina is what absorbs the light, turns it into a neurologic signal, and allows vision to happen. In diabetes, diabetes affects the blood vessels of any part of your body, but including your eye. In retinopathy, those blood vessels, when they're damaged by high blood sugar levels over long periods of time, can start to leak or bleed. And that leaking and bleeding and the side effects that come along with that leaking and bleeding is what retinopathy is. One of the instruments that we use is called a binocular indirect ophthalmoscope. And this is the instrument here. Essentially, we put this on our head. It's a head-mounted pair of oculars with a light so we can see inside of the eye. This is another instrument that you can use to examine the eye. This is called a slit lamp, or it's essentially a microscope with a light beam. We diagnose diabetic retinopathy at an annual ophthalmic exam. So when you come in for an eye exam, we dilate your eyes and we get a good look inside your eyes. We look at the entire retina, and essentially what we're looking for in diabetic retinopathy is any leakage of fluid into the retina, any swelling we see of the retina in the back of the eye, any bleeding in the back of the eye, or any growth of blood vessels that shouldn't be there. Commonly in retinopathy, that's one of the first signs, is blood vessel growth or poor blood vessel growth that shouldn't be there. Well, of course, the primary treatment, or what we'd like to see in our patients, is to prevent retinopathy altogether. But if retinopathy should come about, really there's only one primary treatment for retinopathy at this time. There's some other treatments that are in development, but at this time, essentially, there's laser treatment for the retina. And what occurs in the treatment process is lasers used to sacrifice peripheral retina. And essentially what they do is they take away part of your peripheral vision to allow your central vision or your central retina to survive. Really, the only way to prevent diabetic retinopathy is good control of your diabetes. Good control of diabetes, it means good control of your blood sugar. If you keep your blood sugar well controlled, you may never develop diabetes. Now, in addition to controlling blood sugar well on your own, you really want to seek the appropriate medical care. You want to have annual eye exams so we can catch diabetic retinopathy early on. And if we need to make a change in your medications, that can be done. We want you to see your primary care doctor or endocrinologist regularly and follow their advice. And if you can join an education group or a diabetes education group, or get in touch with the dietitian to learn more about how to eat properly for diabetes, how to exercise for diabetes, that's really how you're going to prevent retinopathy best.
People with diabetes do need to be concerned about body weight, because one of the predisposing facts to developing diabetes is being overweight. So if somebody who has diabetes or pre-diabetes loses weight, it can improve their blood sugar and or change their medication. The reason for that is the more you weigh, the more your body needs insulin. And another thing that's going on with type 2 diabetes is insulin resistance. And again, the amount of fat, the more your body weight is in the form of fat, it promotes insulin resistance. So if somebody with diabetes loses 5 to 10% of their body weight, it can make a huge difference in decreasing this insulin resistance. So an example would be a 200-pound person loses 10 to 20 pounds, even though that's not maybe what your doctor suggested. He may have wanted 50 pounds for you to lose. Losing 10 to 20 pounds will impact your diabetes, will help to lessen this insulin resistance, allow you to use the insulin that you have better, and therefore keep your blood sugar at a better level. Nowadays, we really allow people to have whatever they want, but the key thing is reading labels, knowing portion sizes, and knowing what's in the food that they're eating. We used to not let people have any type of candy or sweet desserts or anything like that. Again, everything is allowed, knowing what's in it, what the portion size is, how much sugar is in the food that they're eating. But we still do like to keep people eating a healthy, balanced diet. It can have a little bit of sugar, but we really want to go for a balanced diet, which would include such things as milk, fruit, and starches, which do contain carbohydrates, which then will eventually turn to sugar. But again, you need these foods for a healthy diet. You just want to have them in a moderate form. And then also we want to add to that diet some source of protein, a healthy lean protein such as fish or meat. And then we would also like to add what we call non-starchy vegetables. And those would be such things as green beans, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, that kind of thing. So that's what we think of when we think of a diabetic diet. We try to think of eating all the food groups, but we're trying to eat them in small portions, and we're trying to eat them in the healthiest form. It depends really on whether you need to lose weight, whether you need to maintain weight, gain weight. It just depends on how active you are. But a rule of thumb is for women, about 45 grams of carbohydrate per meal, possibly up to 60 grams of carbohydrate per meal if they don't need to lose weight. For men, it's about 60 grams to 75 grams of carbohydrate per meal, 60 if you need to lose weight, up to 75 grams if you don't need to lose weight. You can afford to have a little bit more carbohydrate at each meal. And then for a snack, about 15 grams of carbohydrate would be considered a healthy snack choice to have at a snack time. Carbohydrate is just a fancy word for anything that's going to turn to sugar. The difference is a complex carbohydrate is going to turn to sugar slowly in your body, so it's going to prevent a rapid raise of your blood sugar level, whereas a simple carbohydrate will break down very quickly into sugar in your body. So an example of two carbohydrates, one simple and one complex, are a slice of whole wheat bread and a slice of white bread. Both of them have approximately the same amount of carbohydrate, but the complex carbohydrate, which consists of fiber in the whole wheat bread, is going to take longer to process and digest, and therefore will turn to sugar slower, whereas a white slice of bread is basically without any kind of fiber, and the body is able to break down the products very quickly into sugar, and therefore will raise your blood sugar quickly. So with someone with diabetes, we are always encouraging them, when they have their carbohydrate foods, to try to find them in the most complex form, which is usually the highest fiber form.
Diabetes self-management is the foundation of controlling diabetes. How we start with is looking at lifestyle changes, which is the foundation of the treatment. We're looking at weight loss of about 10% of their body weight, as well as adding exercise, typically some type of aerobic exercise, a minimum of 4 times a week, aiming up to 30 minutes to 45 minutes, again, so we can promote weight loss. With the lifestyle changes, we have people start checking their blood sugar so they can see what the lifestyle changes are doing to their actual numbers. And if needed, medications may be started, which could be pills or supplemental insulin or multiple insulin injections, which can be given through a syringe in a bottle or a pre-filled insulin pen or a continuous insulin infusion pump.
A good way to think about planning your meals is, with diabetes, you do want to spread your food intake throughout the day. You don't want to skip meals. You want to make sure that you're getting breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And you can add one or two snacks in between if you need to, or you may need to do that depending on your medication. You'll want to work with your healthcare professional to figure out an exact diet plan, but you definitely want to have three meals a day, and if you need to, one or two snacks throughout the day. You want to have small portions. You don't, for most people with type 2 diabetes, we want to promote that weight loss. So we're encouraging small portions, not large portions of whatever they're eating at that meal time. A good way to think about food when you're in a hurry or when you're out or at the local restaurant is what we call the plate method. And the plate method is just what you see here. What we try to do is encourage about a fourth of our plate to be with some kind of starch, hopefully complex starch such as whole wheat pasta, a small whole wheat roll, a fourth of your plate in some type of a lean meat, whether it's chicken breast or maybe a nice piece of grilled or baked fish, half of your plate with vegetables. What isn't here is a salad. You could also have a salad with some of those non-starchy vegetables and a light vinaigrette or some kind of light salad dressing, a piece of fruit for dessert, and if you were a milk drinker, a small 8-ounce glass of milk. This is a very, very healthy way of eating. Fat is over here in the corner. We encourage you to go light on the fat because fat is the densest form of calories and adds a lot of calories and can promote weight gain. But you can have a little bit of oil, healthy oil on food, but if you can do without it, that's great. So again, half a plate of vegetables, a quarter of a plate with some complex starch, a quarter of a plate with your lean meat or protein, a piece of fruit, and a glass of milk. That's a great way to have a meal, whether you're at your home, at somebody else's home, or at a restaurant.
There is another type of diabetes, gestational diabetes, and that happens with women when they're pregnant. And as soon as the pregnancy goes away, usually the diabetes goes away, but as they get older, they might develop type 2. Diabetes can be prevented, and also sometimes with the prevention program you may develop diabetes, but you will be much healthier and much able to manage diabetes if you do a couple things that are really important to diabetes prevention. One of those things is maintaining a healthy weight, and so you want to eat nutritious foods and include all the food groups in your meal plan. Also getting exercise. Many different associations such as the Medical Association, Endocrine Association, Diabetes Association, suggest 5 days of exercise for 30 minutes each time. It's really going to help prevent a lot of illnesses and diseases, and also we often tell patients it's almost like taking a medication if you can exercise that much. And there are no side effects when you walk, and you do have a better feeling, less depression and all those things, positive endorphins with exercise. So I would say with those two things, if you can do that, you're going to stay healthy for a much longer time.
Well, that's it for this edition of A Prescription for Life. We thank you for joining us. If you have a health topic that you would like to learn more about, you can email us at aprescriptionforlife@yahoo.com. In the meantime, here's hoping your day is a healthy one.